As a member of the anti-diet culture, body positivity, eating disorder recovery community, and as an eating disorder therapist, I really think it's important to touch upon my opinion that thin privilege is a myth. First, welcome to my channel. Welcome back to my channel. My name is Stephanie. I'm Long Island's eating disorder specialist. I post on this channel twice a week, all about eating disorders, body image issues, and general mental health. So if any of that interests you, please click the subscribe button down below. Also, I would encourage you to go into the description and click on my link to subscribe to my email list. At the beginning of each week, I will send you a newsletter, and I create resources to go along with many of my videos. So in that newsletter, if there's any resources to go along with the videos coming out that week, you will get them at that point. I know that there are a lot of opinions on this topic, and I know that mine might be more of an unpopular opinion, especially in the community that I'm in. However, I do strongly believe that thin privilege is a myth, and I hope that you're open to hearing why I believe that and where I'm coming from with that. So in our society, we have recently really have becoming more and more willing to use phrases that put and categorize a bunch of people into a certain category, whether that's the oppressor or the oppressed. And that really can cause its own issues. So when I hear people saying that they have thin privilege, or that there's something called thin privilege, or whatever, male privilege, like there's all these different privileges that is being talked about in our culture right now. It just says to me, first off, it's a very black and white statement. It's like, okay, you may have your own circumstances, but however, if you are male, then your struggles aren't the same as someone else who's not male. Or if you are struggling, but you're technically considered thin, then your struggles aren't as important as, or aren't as hard as someone who has the same struggles, but is also not considered thin. And it just, to me, it sounds like, okay, you, the people who aren't thin, or you, the people who aren't male, or whatever privilege you want to say, and the opposite of that, you are an oppressed group. You are a victim. And that's a very dangerous thing for me. As a therapist, there is a pathology to victimhood, and I don't let my clients sit in a stage of victimhood for very long. And sometimes what made them sick in the first place is falling victim. And this is a really important thing that I want to draw a dichotomy between. So there is absolutely such thing as being a victim. However, where we need to make sure we don't draw the line, or we do draw the line, we cannot fall victim. So being a victim in a certain circumstance, that's what it's referring to. If there was something that happened to you and that you got the short end of the stick, or maybe that's a really light way of saying it, that's not to say I'm invalidating that experience. You can absolutely, and we can identify, and we should identify, that in that situation, you were a victim. You are not someone that should be blaming yourself. You shouldn't be someone who feels guilty. You were the victim. And I know that it's a very fine difference in language. However, while we can identify that in that circumstances, you were the victim, falling victim or falling into the victimhood mentality is a very, very dangerous place for mental health and for society at large. If for my clients, when I'm sitting with them and we can identify that there is something that they have become a victim from in their life, we can acknowledge that, but we can't fall victim. I'm not going to allow my clients to sit very long in that stage and feeling like they are, you know, the world's working against me, this and that, because what is my place in? What am I doing as a therapist? And as therapists, I don't think it's a really responsible thing to continue this narrative that just because you fall into a certain group of people, you are oppressed. I'm not saying that there aren't challenges associated with different things, but that's going along with life, and I'll get that in a moment. However, with my clients, I want to make sure that they don't fall victim, because my job is to empower them. My job is to empower and let them know that they have the ultimate say over their mental health. They have the ultimate responsibility. We can't fall victim to our circumstances. We can't fall victim to society. That's something that's not going to be helpful. And that's where I have a real huge problem with the idea of certain privileges. we have to acknowledge that in our world, we're just more complicated than that. And I just think that there's a gross oversight of an individual level and people as individuals to say, oh, you're not classified as someone who has privilege, therefore your struggles are more valid, or therefore your struggles are harder. We all have certain privileges and we all have certain disadvantages. And sometimes something that causes us to have an advantage is something that causes us to have a disadvantage. And that is life. And that's not necessarily always fair, but there's some sort of balance out there. I hate that there's some narrative that we have in our world today that's continuing this prerogative or this narrative, like I said, of you are oppressed because you don't fall into this certain category. And that's really where I have a problem with in society and how we keep using this narrative to say that this group is oppressed and this group is the oppressors, because then we're just taking those people apart and we're not able to find common ground and to move forward in society, and we're really becoming at a standstill because of that. In the language that I use, I'm very, very careful and scrutinous with regards to the words and the phrases that I use as it pertains to describing society, culture, or a whole group of people. One of the things that you have heard me say in multiple videos is this idea of diet culture. And that is something I don't think it's deniable. I do believe that we really do live in a diet culture, because it's very, very likely that if you go out into the world, you hear people constantly talking about dieting and wanting to lose weight and all that. So that is a language I will use, because there's a lot of evidence to suggest that that is the case, that we do live in a diet culture. Every other commercial is about dieting and fitness and selling this idea that this is going to make you happy. In my eyes, I think that's a very realistic thing to describe the culture as a part of the culture, at least, because it's important that if there is something that exists, we do call it out so that we can really work on it and work against it. At this point in the video, you might be saying, if you stuck around, you might be really frustrated and saying, well, I've seen and I've witnessed thin privilege, I've had thin privilege, or I've seen people get thin privilege. And I want to challenge you on that, and I really want you to be reflective on that. So two things that I want to mention here is that, one, if someone tells you something enough, it could be something that you really start to believe. If someone is constantly telling you for a fact that the sky is green, the sky is green, the sky is green, ultimately, and I know this sounds crazy, but you're going to believe it, even if you see something different. But when you start to believe it, then you actually create a different perception for yourself. So what happens, especially in when we talk about thin privilege, you may have felt that you witnessed it. However, it's really important to note that a lot of times we're creating our own reality, and we evidence search for something that already works with our beliefs. So what I mean by that is, let's say if you were a prosecutor in a court of law and then you have a defense attorney, right? I love watching all those cases and all that stuff. I find it fascinating. And I also find it extremely fascinating how you can have the prosecutor have this super compelling story as to why the person that they are going against is guilty. And it's like, well, I can't see anything else. Like, obviously this person's guilty of sin. And then all of a sudden the defense presents their case and it's like, wow, this person couldn't have done it. I mean, they have such a solid story as to why they have it. They have all the evidence to say that this person is not guilty. And that is a really, I think, a great analogy for this, because what happens is that the prosecutor is going to search for evidence and create the evidence to be in the favor of the prosecution, while the defense would do the same thing, but for in defense of the person. That's the thing that happens. We search, and it's kind of like confirmation bias. We search for evidence. Well, it is confirmation bias. We search for evidence that confirms our beliefs and our thoughts. And that is something that can happen, and why you may believe that thin privilege actually exists. That, let's say, if you get all dolled up and you've noticed that people are treating you very differently and in a positive way, is it possible that it's not thin privilege or cute privilege or pretty privilege or whatever you want to call it? But is it possible that you actually feel very differently about yourself and you feel more confident, therefore you're going out and presenting yourself in a way and giving this aura off about you that is being received by others, therefore they're treating you differently? Something to think about. And I really hope that while I respect anyone else's opinion, if they totally disagree with me, that's absolutely fine. But I truly hope that you at least take this in and think about it and reflect and really just know that there might be other alternatives other than what society tells you, because society will make you believe anything that it wants you to believe. If you listen to it, then that's something that they have a hold over you. But I hope that when it comes to anything, that you always look at it with a healthy dose of scrutiny and really just trying to reflect for yourself. Is there something else that could be true? Especially if whatever is being fed to you is hurting you in any way. So I hope that this is giving you something to maybe think about at the very least, and maybe even change your mind and hopefully help you. If you found this video helpful, I'd greatly appreciate if you gave it a thumbs up so that other people can hopefully find this video and it can help them as well. I'm super curious to hear your thoughts on this, so leave a comment down below about whether you disagree, you agree, your thoughts. I'm really interested in hearing about that. You could click my face over here to subscribe to my channel, and I wish you a healthy dose of scrutiny on your journey to finding your state of balance, and I will see you in my next video.